instructions we have seen, arithmetical instructions, logical instructions, okay. And we will discuss the next available group of instructions in our present class. Okay. If you want me to start the class, please message someone. Please message. Yes. Okay. In today's class, we will continue. So in that, we will be discussing about data transfer instructions. Okay. Okay. See here, data transfer type of instructions. The mostly used instructions in our programming are data transfer type of instructions, because definitely we need to take if you're performing some arithmetic operation or logical operations. So you need to take content into some particular register, and definitely the second register will be accumulator. You need to perform some operation, and the result once again it will be stored in accumulator. So the mostly used instructions are these particular data transfer instructions. So first instruction is move a comma hash n. So when you see hash n, definitely you will understand this is what data. Okay, move a comma hash 25. Content 25 is moving into accumulator. Similarly, move a comma RR. RR means it is indicating RAM registers. So what are the RAM registers available? So R0 to R7 in four different banks. Okay. What is happening if I am writing move a comma R0? So content available in R0 will be loaded into accumulator. Okay. Move a comma address. Some specific address. How to specify the address in our instruction? Directly you need to write the number. Okay, without any hash or address, simply you need to mention the number. That means the content available in this particular address will be loaded in our accumulator. Next type is what? Move a comma @RP. Already we have discussed this thing in our addressing modes and in our previous class. So what is happening here? @RP. RP stands for register pointer. We have restricted ourselves for only R0 and R1 to reduce number of opcodes. And RP, what is happening, sir, here? The content available in a memory location pointed out by this register content is loaded in accumulator A. So what is happening, see? The content which is available in a memory location whose address is pointed out by R0 content, R0 register, will be loaded into A. Okay. Now coming to next case. So similarly, you have different cases. Move @R0, A. Move 25 comma A. So different things, you can repeat these things, okay, by exchanging for operand 1 and operand 2 or source with destination. Okay, now coming to these things, move address 1 comma address 2. Okay, so this thing is not possible in our microprocessor, which is possible in microcontroller because memory is internal. Okay, move 20h comma 30h. So what will happen here? The content which is available in 30h, that content will be loaded into 20h. Take an example, X is available. After this instruction, what will happen? This content X will be copied from content 30H address and it will be loaded into 20H address memory location. Clear? Now, when we see X here, move X, definitely what you understand, you are dealing with external memory, that is external RAM. Okay. Move X, a comma @DPTR. What will happen, sir? So RAM, external RAM will be having 16-bit address that has to be loaded into DPTR, which is a 16-bit register. Okay, then the memory location which is pointed by this particular DPTR, that content available in that register will be loaded into A. Okay. Similarly, you can do reverse. The content which is available in A, you can load that content into the memory location whose address is pointed out by DPTR. Okay. I'm explaining the example here. Consider X is available here. Okay, X is available in accumulator. Now I'm loading this X with the help of this instruction number 2. So the content of accumulator will be loaded into the memory location whose address is pointed out by this register DPTR 2000. Okay, the content will be X will be loaded in this memory location whose address is pointed out by this memory this register DPTR. Okay. Okay. Wait for a moment. Small distance. Yeah, sorry for the disturbance. Now coming to third instruction, move X A comma at the rate R naught. So you need to concentrate here. Why I have underlined this move X? So generally when we are saying move X means we are dealing with external RAM, and definitely we will go with DPTR because it is a 16-bit register, and RAM is external RAM is having what 16-bit address. But in our addressing modes, we have seen three cases. Case 1, you are dealing with internal RAM. Case 2, you are dealing with external RAM. Case 3, you are dealing with, sorry, case 1 is what? You are dealing with external RAM using R0 and R1. Second case, using DPTR. Third case is that you are dealing external RAM with 8-bit registers R0 and R1. How to deal, sir? So this is what your address. I have explained the same thing, repeating just, okay? It will start from 000. All the four zeros to all four Fs, but I am selecting this part. Okay, if it is zero means I will be able to load only the content pointed by this 8-bit address 00 to FF. So these addresses can be loaded into R0, and they can be that content available in this particular locations can be transferred into A, or from A you can load into this thing. Okay, that is possible. Now same thing, move X comma at the rate R0 comma N. What is happening, sir, here? The content available in accumulator will be loaded into the memory location whose address is pointed out by this R0. I think these things are very clear, simply repetition. Now if you want to perform move operations with ROM, we have seen that for internal RAM you will use move, for external RAM you will use move X, but for ROM, okay, what you will be using, you will be using move C. Move C means move code. Okay, so what are the instructions available? Move code A comma at the rate A plus DPTR. What will happen, sir? The combined address generated by this A plus DPTR, so that will be pointing to a memory location. The content available in that memory location will be loaded into accumulator. Okay, we have seen this in our index in the addressing mode. Okay, very clearly. Second thing is what? Move A comma at the rate A plus PC. Once again, the combined address generated by A plus PC will be pointing to a memory location. The content available in that memory location will be loaded into A. Okay. Now, simple question. If I want to add contents of two memory locations whose addresses are 20H and 21H, and I want to store the result in 22H, how to perform this operation, sir? It is very simple, because you have done programmings of, we have done large programs adding. Starting from adding of numbers to finding the odd number and even number, finding the positive number to negative number. So we have performed different programs. So you are, it is very, very easy to you to do these things. So what you will do, sir? Move A comma 20H, add A comma 21H content. Okay, that result you need to move in 22H. So move 22 comma A. So sir, this is very easy. This is a simple task. But why you are asking this simple task to us? So I want to highlight one thing here, that it is very, very easy, okay, it is very, very easy to perform this operation, moving, adding the contents of two memory locations and placing the result in third memory location, which is very easy if you are dealing with internal RAM. So internal RAM will be having what? 8-bit address. If I want to do the same thing with respect to external RAM, okay, that becomes a little difficult, okay. So first I will explain what are the difficulties you will face when you are dealing with external RAM, then how to use the instructions to perform the same operations. Okay, let us see the question. Add the contents of 2000H and 2001H and store the result in 2002. So because you are using 16-bit address, definitely it means what? External RAM. Okay, what are the problems you are going to face here? See, Here you can't use direct addressing mode, simply you need to use indirect addressing mode. To carry the 16-bit address, definitely what you need to use, definitely you need to go with DPTR, okay? Increment of DPTR to access the next. So definitely you need to follow this instruction in your program. And one more thing, to add the contents of external RAM, you can't write directly add X, okay? So this instruction is not available. Hence what I can say, directly you can't add external RAM contents. Now, what is the communication link between our microcontroller and external RAM? We need to go every time. We need to go either to load the content. You can see red arrow mark. If you are loading content from controller to RAM, okay, you need to go with accumulator. Once again, if you are taking content from RAM, you can see this black arrow mark, okay, left hand direction. So definitely you need to go with A. So only the channel which is connecting microcontroller and external RAM is accumulator. So these things make our program little bit difficult, okay? See here, for this operation you require only three instructions, because you need to take the content in accumulator, add the contents, result will be in accumulator. Simply you can load that content in the desired location. But here you can't take the data directly, so that data, that address has to be taken in 16 bit register. So every time the DPTR has to be incremented, and then you need to perform the loading from controller to RAM or from RAM to controller. Okay, see what will happen. Okay, add the contents. Once again, I'm reading the question. If you understand the question, you can do it in your own way. So add contents of 2000 and 2001 and place the result in 2002. So see these numbers. If you are clear with these numbers, you can easily write this program. See, first of all, what I will do, I will load 16-bit content, okay, that address, 16-bit address into my DPTR, okay. Then what I need to do, take the contents from this location into accumulator, okay. Immediately, I can't take the same content, content of next location into accumulator, because this will be overwriting our previous content. So, listen, okay, DPTR should be initialized with the address, okay. Then what you need to do, take the content into accumulator. Now this content has to be loaded in some other register, third instruction. Then you need to access this 2001, that means you need to increment. So you have performed here number 3 and now it is 3 dash, okay. You need to increment DPTR. So the content available in this 2001 will be loaded into A using 4, okay. Now you can add A and R0 in using number 5, and then you can load into 6. But before loading, what you need to do, sir, you need to increase DPTR, because you can't load in you can't write the content in 2001, you need to store in 2002. So 5 dash is what, 2002, you have incremented the DPTR content. This location is available now. Now you are transferring that content, the result you are transferring into 2002. See here, this is very simple and very easy. What you have done here, the same thing I am writing in the form of instructions, okay. First, initialize DPTR with 2000. So what is the instruction? Move DPTR comma hash 2000. That means this 2000 is taken as content into our DPTR. Okay. After that, it is pointing to an address. Okay. Now, move X comma A at the rate of DPTR. Why I am mentioning X, sir? Sir, if you are accessing a 16-bit address, that is definitely it is pointing to external RAM. So when you are dealing with external RAM, you need to go with move X. See, move X A comma at the rate DPTR. So the content which is available in a memory location whose address is pointed by this DPTR, that will be loaded into accumulator. Okay, you can see number 2. Okay, now third thing, what should happen? You should store this A into some register. Okay, what I am doing? Move R0 comma A. Contents will be loaded into R0. Now you need to increment DPTR, so 3 dash, you have loaded this thing into R0. Now 3 dash means incrementing DPTR, increment DPTR, so it will point to 2001. Now move X A comma at the rate of DPTR, the content available in 2001 location will be loaded into A, okay. Now what you need to do, add these two contents, A plus R0, using instruction number 5, add A comma R0. Now you need to store the result, but before storing the result, what you need to do? You need to increment DPTR. So 5 dash is indicating what? Increment DPTR. Okay. Now what you will do, you will move the result into, how you will move? Once again you need to use move x at the rate dptr comma a. The result which is available in accumulator will be loaded into memory location whose address is pointed out by dptr content. Is it clear? Okay, so I have explained you what are the difficulties when you are dealing with this external RAM and how to overcome those difficulties. Okay, so simply you need to see, you may get confused with move x and move. So when simply you are loading, you need to go with move. When you are loading from external RAM, then you need to definitely go with move x. Okay, the previous slide was very clear. Now coming to branch instructions. Okay, we have seen number of programs using this branch instructions. So we have generated square wave. How to generate square waves? So we have taken 00h and we have generated some delay. A separate program was written in some place. Okay, a separate program was written and we called that particular program number of times to increase the delay, and after reaching that specified delay we have incremented. That means from 00 we have changed to 01 or ff, okay, any desired number. Then again we have maintained the same delay, okay, by calling that delay program sub program. Okay, so that is what we have used the branching. What is branching, sir? So if I am continuing an instruction, okay, if I am writing a program continuously, so what will happen? My program counter register will be incrementing by one every time. So this is normal sequence. But if some interrupt has occurred, or purposefully I am jumping to some desired instruction, I want to access some desired part of a program which is not available in our sequence, so what I will do, I will jump to that particular sub program. Or if some interrupt has occurred, automatically what will happen, to provide service to that interrupt, I will definitely stop my sequential execution and I will jump to that particular interrupt, solve the interrupt. That means I will provide service to that interrupt and then will come back. So I think you are familiar with these things. Okay, not new to this. These are not new topics to you people. Okay, here branch control instructions. Here 21 instructions are available. We will see one by one. So what is the purpose here? So these are used to change the content of PC. That means in general what will happen, it will increment by one. So we will not perform that thing in our branch instruction. Simply we want our PC to hold the address of our sub program or the desired part of the program. We will make this PC to hold that particular desired address. Okay, so in general what is happening here, it will increment sequentially. So in this branching means definitely you will remember two things, jump instruction as well as call instruction. So before entering into our branch instructions, so let us see what is the difference, basic difference between jump and call. I think you can easily differentiate. What is jump, sir? So if you are starting your program execution from this part, after reaching this particular part, here you can see a jump instruction will be available. Jump to this specified location. So what you will do, you will jump to this specified location and you will continue the normal execution from here. Okay, this is regarding jump. But in our call instruction, what will happen? You will start your execution from this point. Okay, this point. You will continue up to this point, and here you can see call instruction. Call to some label. Okay, call to some particular label. That label will be available here. And you will go to this sub program, provide execution, you will do the execution here and you will return. Definitely you can see a return instruction. Now you can return to this address, okay, and you will continue the normal execution. So what is happening, sir, here? What is the basic difference here? After jumping, you won't come back to the next address, but here when you are jumping to some specific part of the program, sub program, definitely you will return to next address. So, and one more thing, every call will be followed by return instruction. Definitely here is nothing like that. Okay, so these are the basic difference. You are well aware of these things. Okay, now coming to jump instruction. In jump instruction you have three things. Sjump, it stands for short jump. So sjump command, sjump address, some address will be available here, so it will jump to this particular address. Second one is ajump comma ajump address. Okay, comma is not available. Ajump space address. So what is this ajump? Stands for absolute jump. Okay, ljump is what? Long jump. Okay, what is the difference in these three jumps? So S jump, the name itself, it is indicating it can jump to a shorter distance. So it can jump from that current instruction, current address to 127 bytes in forward direction. In backward direction, it can jump from up to minus 128 bytes. Coming to absolute jump, it can jump anywhere up to 2 kilobytes. Okay, from that particular current instruction, it can jump up to any location up to 2 kilobytes. 2 kilobytes it can jump using absolute jump. Now coming to long jump. Okay, so in general we say there is no restriction. It can jump to any location from any location. So if you are very much specific, if you want to know what is the number, sir, so then it is up to 64 kb. So our expandable memory, so maximum memory microcontroller can handle or it can access is what, 64 kb. That means it can jump from anywhere to anywhere. So because of that reason I have mentioned here, it is having no restriction to jump anywhere. Okay, so I think this is very clear. S jump means short jump, minus 128 in backward direction, and in forward direction it can jump up to plus 128 bytes. Absolute jump, anywhere it can jump up to 2 kilobytes. Okay, in long jump, no restrictions, or it can jump up to 64 kb. okay, now coming to call instructions. So there are once again two types of calls: absolute call, comma, some label will be available here. You can't write the address here. So in call instruction we will be using label. Label is what? It is the name given to a particular address. Here in jump instructions you can use directly some, you can use label or you can use the address. Okay, but here we are using what? Some label. So I have used the label sub. Why I have used this sub means I am jumping to some sub program or to some subroutine part. Okay, absolute jump and long, sorry, absolute call and long call. And coming to next thing, so every call will be followed by return instruction. Okay, so in this return you have two things: return instruction, normal return, RET, RET, and next one is RET I. So for the first time we are seeing this instruction RET I. So definitely there should be difference between RET and RET I. So what is the difference between these things? I will explain. Okay, so first thing, consider normal call here. Okay, call comma subroutine. Okay, call this sub. So this is the label. So what will happen, sir? You concentrate on this black ink part. So what will happen in general? So when you are jumping to this particular sub program, this particular label, what you will do? You will push the contents of your program counter into stack. Okay, what is that content? Okay, program counter will be, when you are dealing with this call, program counter will be holding the address of next instruction. Okay, so this address is what, the return address where you need to come back. Okay, you will definitely remember this address, but how to remember this address? You need to store in a specific part of memory, that is what, stack. You will be loading what, you are pushing this program counter content, that is return address, into stack. Okay, and then after you will go to this subroutine part or sub program, you will go up to this part, you will come across, you will encounter this return instruction, you will come back. While coming back, what you will do, sir? You will pop the contents of stack. What will happen? So the content which is loaded with the push, that will be loaded into program counter. That is what you are loading indirectly. You are loading return address. So you will get the return address and you will continue the execution here. So I have taken an example in our classroom that during your vacations, if you are going to some other state or some other area, so what you will do after logging your home, you will place keys, and definitely you will remember where you have placed in the key. So that is nothing but our return address. I have taken that example, but now I will take the example of class once again here to differentiate between return and RET I. Okay, now consider we are in class. I'm writing a program. So I have encountered with this call instruction. That means I have encountered with an interrupt. Okay, suppose I have encountered with an interrupt. Okay, before going to this interrupt, I have some interrupt. Okay, so interrupt or indirectly what I'm saying, I'm writing, I have stopped this thing and I am writing some part to explain this call. I'm writing or drawing this diagram. Okay, I have written some 10 instructions. at 11th instruction, I need some explanation. So I am stopping this instruction and I'm moving to the right hand side of the board and I will write some diagram. What I will do after completion of the diagram, I will return. Okay, that is simple. I am in need of some extra diagram here. That is like a sub program. I will move there, but I will remember where I have stopped. So I will move to that diagram. I will complete that drawing part and I will return to this thing and I will continue. So during that thing, I will return using this normal instruction RET return. Okay. So this is what RET is used to deal with sub programs or functions. Okay. Simply what you can say, this is what your subroutine. Okay. So when you are going or when you are dealing with subroutine, okay, you will jump to that sub program or subroutine program. When you encounter this return, you will come back. So this thing will happen. It is normal. Okay. Now I will explain about interrupt. So interrupt is a special case here. Okay. Consider I am in class. I am writing, I have written up to 10 instructions. While I am writing this 11th instruction, a person has knocked our classroom door and he has interrupted me. So what I will do, sir? Okay, what I will do? So I will provide service to that interrupt. Okay. While moving to that particular person, what I will do, I will store in my memory. So where to return after handling this interrupt, I will return, but what should be my address? Okay, I will remember what is the instruction I was explaining. So I will move to that particular person, okay, interrupt, okay, and then I will come to return I. So when I am dealing with interrupts, I won't use return. Instead of that, I will use ret I. So this is what, when you are dealing with interrupts, you will use ret I and then you will come back. But what is the difference here? So if you see in this way, both ret and ret I both are same, but there is a difference. See, once again, I will explain the example. So I was explaining 11th instruction, but an interrupt has occurred. Okay, interrupt has occurred. So what I will do? So before going to that particular interrupt or particular person, I will inform my students. Okay, I will consider my students as internal interrupts. So you may be asking doubts. Okay, while I am explaining, you may be asking doubts. So that interrupts are internal interrupts. Okay, so I will inform you. Okay, please don't ask doubts when I am dealing with the external person. That means I am disabling you people. That means internal interrupts are disabled here. So before moving to this sub program or this interrupt, okay, before moving to that external person, what I am asking, so please don't ask any question when I am dealing with this external person. Okay, I am disabling you people. I am dealing with this external person. I will handle, okay, whatever the situation, I will talk to him, complete the situation, and I will return to this next address or returning address with the help of RET I. So why I am using this RET I means, while returning, okay, while returning to this instruction, I will inform you people, I will inform my students that, okay, now you can ask any doubts, okay, and I will go to this particular instruction and we will continue the programming part. So during this returning, I will use this return instruction. So what is happening here? So during return, it will return to our return address as well as the interrupts are enabled. That means our students are enabled to ask questions or doubts. I think this is very clear. Okay. Once again, I will explain this thing. In a normal situation, when I'm using a sub program, so I will write this, when I'm writing this normal program, main program. So if I'm in need of some sub program, what I will do? I will stop here and I will move to that sub program or a diagram to explain you. I will continue this part after completion of this thing. I will come back with the help of return instruction to this particular address. Okay, that is what normal, that is what we are dealing with subroutine. This is what subroutine, normal. When I am dealing with interrupt, okay, when you are dealing with the interrupt, what is happening? See, so definitely I will use this call instruction. While moving to this thing, I will ask my students, please don't ask any questions when I am dealing with this interrupt. So indirectly what I will say, the controller is in, it is disabling the interrupts. Okay, then what it will do, it will deal with this interrupt, provide service to this interrupt, and using this RET I, I will, the controller will return to this particular program counter address or return address. Okay, but during return, it will enable all the interrupts. So this is the difference of using RET and RET I. Okay, I hope you have understood these things very clear. So if you are interested, you can see this thing. All ISRs, interrupt service routines, are subroutines. Okay, interrupt service routines are subroutines, but all subroutines are not ISRs. Okay, that means definitely you will jump to the sub program. Okay, that is what subroutine. But interrupts are a special case of this subroutine. But every interrupt is definitely a subroutine. But all subroutines will not be ISRs, because in subroutine you will go without disabling these interrupts. But in ISRs, definitely you will disable these interrupts. Okay. I think this is very clear. Now coming to conditional jumps. Okay, conditional jumps. So you know that if a particular condition is satisfied, then only it will jump to that particular memory location or that particular label. Okay, if a condition is not satisfied, what will happen? It will go with next instruction. So it will execute next instruction. Okay, now CJNE, what it will do, sir? So you can see here, it will compare and jump if not equal. Okay, where it will jump? It will jump to the specified label. So first thing is what? It will compare these two things, X and Y. It will compare these two things. If these two things are not equal, then it will jump to this particular label. If they are equal, what it will do? It will jump to, if they are not equal, they simply it will move to next instruction. See, once again, it will compare these two instructions, X and Y, two register contents or in one register or some address content, okay, memory location content. It will compare these two things. If they are not equal, definitely the control of execution will be jumping to this particular label. So what are the types available here? Okay, these are once again very easy and repetition part. So compare and jump if equal, if not equal, A comma hash 25, that means content of A and this number 25 will be compared. If they are not equal, you will jump to label, this particular label. Once again here, compare and jump if not equal, A comma 25, that means it is what address, some content is available in this address, in this memory location pointed out by this address. So that content and this A will be compared. If they are not equal, you will jump to label. Similarly, compare and jump if not equal, R not comma, content of this R not and this number will be compared. If not, you will jump here. Once again, content available in a memory location pointed out by this R not, okay, pointed out by this R not will be compared with number 25. If they are not equal, you will jump to this particular label. Okay. Now, next thing. So the most oftenly used instruction in our programming, in microcontroller programming, is what? DJNZ. So what is DJNZ here? Decrement and jump if not zero. See here, what is the syntax here? DJNZ, count comma label, decrement and jump if not zero. You can place the number, simply you can use the number here, or you can place the number in your register. Decrement and jump if not zero. If this content is not zero, then you need to jump to this particular label. If it is zero, what will happen, sir? It will simply go to next instruction. Okay, so what are the types available? DJNZ, R7 comma back. I'm using the label name with the name back. Second thing is DJNZ comma 25 back. So 25 is specifying here. 25 is what? Address. So in general, we don't use this instruction because we have abundant instruction, abundant registers. R0 to R7 instructions of bank 0, R0 to R7 registers of bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, and bank 3. But we will not use R0 and R1. Why, sir? We are using them, R0 and R1, as register pointers. So we will start from R3 to R7. Okay. In my example, I am considering R7. See why I am not using R0 to R1? Because they are acting as register pointers. So because of that reason, I will use from R3 to R7 of bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, and bank 3. So in my example, I will consider R7. It's up to you. You can use any register. Okay. Methods of looping. So definitely, because when we are dealing with this loop programs, we will use this DJNZ or CJNZ. Okay. So what type of loopings are available? How you will generate loops? Okay. I will generate loop using unconditional jump. Okay, unconditional jump. Using unconditional jump. So what are the unconditional jumps are available? S jump, L jump, A jump, they are available. So where you will jump? You will jump to that specified label. Okay, consider the example here. Okay, my programming has started from this point. I have started writing the instructions and I have written here back and a particular instruction. And after reaching this S jump, what will happen? I will jump to this back label. So I'm interested to perform looping of this particular area from this back instruction to this SJMP. What will happen, sir? For the first time, see here, from the first time, I will start from this point. I will come to this particular back and I will enter into this thing. Okay, I will reach to this SJMP instruction. So what it will do, SJMP to back, simply it will jump to back without verifying any condition. Okay, once again from back it will come to SJMP, it will go to back. How many times it will do, sir? It will continuously do this thing until, okay, that means it will continuously do only this thing. That is, you have formed an infinite loop here. Using unconditional jump, you can generate infinite loop. But the question arises, so where you will use this infinite loop, sir? Why I am interested to generate infinite delay, or infinitely I am using this particular part only. So where you will use this infinite loop? The answer is very easy. So in our digital clock, we are using what? We have three things: seconds display, minutes display, and hours display. So what should happen, sir? After 60 seconds, this seconds display should become 0 and minutes display should become 1. So after 60 minutes, minutes display should become 0 and hours display should become 1. So after 24 hours, what should happen, sir? If you are using 24 hours clock, it's up to you. You can use 12 or 24. If I'm using 24 hours clock, so if after reaching 24 hours, what will happen, sir? At that moment, everything will become 0. Seconds display will become 0. Minutes display will become 0, hours display will become 0, and then once again it will start looping. Okay, once again what should happen, sir? It should start with seconds, it should reach 60 seconds, and then minutes should become 1. So continuously, so this process should take place for 1 day? No, it should take for 2 day? No, so it should take place continuously, infinite. Okay, because of that reason, it should our clock should work continuously. So for that reason, we are using infinite loop in our digital clocks. Okay, I think it is very clear here. Coming to second thing, finite loop. Okay, I am generating some finite loop. So using this instruction DJNZ. Okay, so I will start from here. Suppose my programming has started here. I have started a program. So I will continue up to this part. I have written a back label here, and I will continue up to this thing. So why I have written back here means I am interested to perform looping, or I am interested to use this particular part of the program repeatedly. Okay, so I will write here what DJNZ, some register content R7, comma back. So before this, before I will initialize this register with some content. So here in our example, I have initialized R7 with 5. That means I'm interested to use this part of the program 5 times. Okay, so what will happen? For the first time, I will come from this part, I will write back here. Okay, and then I will move up to this thing. Okay, DJNZ, I will verify. So DJNZ means decrement and jump if not 0. So for the first time, it will decrement to 4, it is not 0, so it will jump back, jump to this back label. Continuously it will happen until it becomes 0. So 5 times you are performing loop here. After 5 times, what will happen? It will move to this next instruction. It will continue normal execution. Okay. Okay, how to generate the question here is a question that how to generate 256 iterations. Okay, see here, see the previous slide. If I want to generate 10 iterations, okay, 10 iterations means if I want to use this part of the program 10 times, so what will be the content here, sir? 10. If I want to use this part of the program some 20 times, so what should be the content here? 20. But if I want to use, okay, if I want to repeatedly use this part of the program 256 times, okay, 256 times, how, sir? So the idea may come in your mind that simply I will write, sir, FF here. Okay, so I will write FF, but FF is what it is representing, 255. So you can be able to perform looping of this specified part of the area only for 255 times, but not 256 times. Okay, if you are interested in this particular part, in this particular question, how to perform 256 iterations using 8-bit register, you can message me. I will explain that part. Okay, it's up to you. Okay, before explaining that part, I'm giving this thing as an homework to you people. just work it out how to get 256 iterations using 8 bit register. Okay, try. If you try, you will get the answer. If you don't get, I will explain. Okay, in next class. Okay. Now see here. Coming to this conditional jumps. Okay. Concentrate here. You have what conditional jump? Jump if carry to this particular label. Jump if no carry this particular label. Jump if no zero to this particular label. Jump if no zero to particular label. So, but you may have a wrong notion here that this Z is indicating zero flag. No sir, we don't have zero flag in our 8051. So this is indicating what? So here this carry. Okay, these instructions are working on what? Carry flag. Verifying that this carry flag is zero or one. Okay, based on that it will perform the operation. But here for JZ and JNZ, they are verifying the contents of accumulator. If the contents of accumulator are zero, then they will jump to this particular thing. If it is not zero, it won't jump. But it is not verifying directly the zero flag because zero flag is not available in 8051. Okay, one more jump is available, but that is what? Unconditional jump. Jump at the rate a comma a plus dptr. So we have seen in indexed addressing mode that we are using this combined address a plus dptr. So what will happen, sir? The combined address generated by this a plus dptr, that address, okay, it will jump, simply it will jump without verifying any condition. It will jump to this particular memory location. Okay. Last type of jumps. Okay. Bitwise or Boolean. So we have seen what bitwise instructions or Boolean instructions. Okay. To change the contents of a particular bit. Okay. You have seen that in our internal RAM structure from 20 to 2F, that memory locations are specifying bit addressable area. That means that registers, okay, that memory locations, 8 bits are available individually. You can change the contents of that bits using this bitwise instructions or Boolean instructions. Okay, similarly you can perform jumps. How to perform those things? Let's see here. JB bit comma label. So how to read this thing, sir? JB, here it is what? Jump if bit. Verify this bit and jump to this label. What is this? So you need to understand this clearly. So I have written here clearly. Okay. JB is what? Jump if bit. Jump if this particular bit is set. Okay. Bit nothing but set. So jump if this bit is set. Which bit is set, sir? So here your bit is available. I will verify. Jump if this particular bit is one or not. If this bit is what? One, then you need to jump to this label. Okay. This is your syntax. Now I am taking an example. So JB means jump if bit. Jump if P0.3 bit is set to this particular label down. Okay. If P0.3 is set or 1, then you will jump to this label down. If it is not set, that is if it is 0, you won't jump. Simply you will go to next instruction. Okay. See here. I have taken an example here. So you have started programming. So when you encounter this instruction, jump if bit P0.3 is set. If P0.3 is set, then you will jump to this label down and you will go to this thing. So in we have seen in call and jump instruction differences that you won't come back again. You will continue the normal execution from this point. Okay. Now, so which registers are bit addressable instructions? So see here, I have mentioned the list here. Accumulator B register, PSW, P0, P1, P2, P3, SCON, TCON, PCON, IE and IP are bit addressable registers. Okay. Now, second instruction, jump if bit is not set, jump if not bit, comma, jump if not bit, bit, comma, label. So how to read these things, sir? I have mentioned here. Jump if not bit. Not bit means, bit means set, not set. So how to read? Jump if not set. Jump if not set. So I will take this example and I will explain here. Jump if this bit is not set to this label. Okay. Once again, jump if P0.4 bit is not set. That means it is zero. If P0.4 is zero, then you need to jump to this particular label. Okay. Once again, jump if P0.4 bit is not set to this particular label. Okay, this thing is very clear. So jump if bit is set, to this particular label, jump if this particular bit is not set to this particular label. Okay, third thing is what? JBC. Okay, JBC, it is specifying what? Jump if bit clear. Okay, jump if bit is clear or jump if bit is complement. So taking this example, JBC P0.7 comma again, my label is what? Again. So what is happening here, sir? Jump to again, jump to the label again if P0.7 is set. Okay, and one more thing. Okay, here two operations you need to perform. Okay, jump if, okay, see here, before seeing this example, see third example, you see the example one, JB is what, sir? Jump if bit is set. If this bit is set, you need to jump here. Okay, now see the third instruction, JBC. So first you need to concentrate only JB. What will happen, sir? Jump if this bit is sent to label. Okay, it will jump, definitely will jump if this bit is set. And the second operation, what it will perform? Clear this particular bit. It will jump first and then it will clear the contents. So taking this example, JBC P0.7 to this label again. So what is happening, sir, here? Jumps to again. Okay, jumps to again if P0.7 is set, but while jumping, it will clear P0.7. Sorry. See here, two operations are performed here. First operation is what? It will jump to this particular label if this bit is set in our example. So it will jump to label again if P0.7 is set. Okay, it will jump definitely, but while jumping, what it will do? It will clear P0.7. Okay, or here I have mentioned what? Jump if bit is set to clear or complement. Means, that means it is set, means one, definitely it will jump and it will clear. Clear means you are clearing a bit which is set, means you are complementing that bit. So both are same. Okay, so with this, our today's session will end. If you have any doubts, you can ask. Okay.